Hey guys, what's going on? Paul here. Welcome back to an overdue Cardano video at this stage. But in this one, we'll get into post Cardano Vasil Hardfork. What does that actually mean? What are some of the improvements we're already seeing and what's actually next? A big DEX on Cardano that is building on top of Cardano has had a major rebrand, looking to bring some exciting stuff to the chain. We'll touch on that as well as some other things around the ecosystem as well. Timestamps will be below as normal. Share it out, like, comment, subscribe, all of that good stuff. I do appreciate it. It does help the channel. Let's jump into it. Okay, so two videos I'm going to talk about in this one as well are Cardano 360 from last week, and Charles done a really good video last night, a live stream on Basho and Voltaire. We'll touch on that one as well. Starting out with Cardano 360, I'll put links to all of this below because I'm only going to touch on certain points and you can check them out in full yourselves. Development update was all about Vasil, how things have went. Things went smoothly, everything went well, and what we're already seeing improvements is the overall summary. And we had the usual team on for that if you want to check it out. It's just 5 or 6 minutes at the start of the video there. And one of the things they touched on was block propagation times. So this is how fast new blocks are shared across the network. One big improvement we're seeing there is the average block propagation time down from around 1300 milliseconds to 600. This means that newly created blocks are being shared across the network a lot faster. One potential thing that can happen here is because the current blocks are being shared across so quick, I would say we could probably easily bump the block size, so make bigger blocks, increase the overall max block size to allow more transactions into blocks if we needed it, and it would still go across the network well within the current targets. Block propagation will also feed into input endorsers, which I'll talk about when we get to Charles's video because he had a section on that one. Right now, capacity, we don't need to increase the block size because the current capacity on Cardano is being handled, or the current usage is being handled very well by what the chain can actually take right now. But again, we'll touch on that one in a minute. Some projects on, some other updates like Stanford, Haskell Bootcamp, Mongolia, Mithril. Interesting to get an update there on how things are going. If you haven't looked into Mithril, it's probably worth looking into if you're interested in, I suppose, in the technical side and how Mithril might be used with light clients and stuff like that going forward. Cardano Foundation, we're on to talk about the Cardano Summit, which is happening in November. And I'm hoping to get out to Switzerland, which will be the main event for that, to meet some of the community, projects, everything like that, and to thank people who have supported me on this channel and my stake pool from I started them way back at this stage. Cardano is 5 years old as well, so happy birthday to Cardano. Other events, Marco was on from CNFT Con, and that's happening in Vegas this weekend. Looks like it's going to be a great event. And Peyton was on from Rare Bloom, which happens the week after in Denver, Colorado as well. I think there's still tickets available for both, and I'll leave the links to them down below, or just Google them or check out on Twitter as well. So if we move on then to look a bit more on the improvements from Vasil. So this is a screenshot, or not a screenshot, this is a page on Pool Tool that I've showed a good few times. You can see here the block propagation of the last block was well below the 600 milliseconds I talked about there as the average. So great to see these types of numbers here. I will do a video at some point explaining some of the stats that are on this page and see what other ones I can bring into it as well. For people who are interested in more of how the network is actually performing as well, this is what we're concentrating on before, looking at how many SPOs and pools were upgraded to the latest Vasil Hardfork version. So it's at 100% now, because if you're not on that one, then you're not producing blocks. I think there's still a few pools out there that are on the older one. So if you are delegated, make sure that your pool is still creating blocks as well. Other improvements, we look at Muesliswap put out the power of Vasil. So they're close to launching their Plutus V2 scripts, and here are some of the amazing benchmarks. So they have a V1 transaction here going from a size of 14.73 kilobytes down to a size of 1.31 kilobytes. So nearly a 90% reduction. A lot of that is down to the improvements in Plutus. And I would say a big one there is reference scripts, where you don't have to include the script in every transaction with V1. What you had to do was include the script anytime you're interacting with a smart contract. Now you don't have to do that, you can just reference it. So that takes a big size out of the individual transactions. And then with that, it brings a cost decrease as well, going from 1.44 ADA in V1 down to 0.73 ADA in V2. So on scripts as well, or on how this works. So dApps that are running V1 scripts, then them ones will continue to work perfectly the way they always have, but they just have to include the script in them, and they can't take advantage of some of the other improvements as well. With V2 scripts, then you can take advantage of everything that Vasil has brought, but the older V1 contracts will all have to be upgraded by the individual dApps. So each dApp will bring out updates and announcements on when they're doing that, in case you have to do anything. But your funds and everything like that are always going to be safe. You are the only one that can interact with them. So another one then was JPGstore. They put out this one here, how they've decreased network fees by 50%. So JPGstore would be the number one NFT marketplace on Cardano right now. So they've upgraded to Plutus V2. And you can see smaller transaction size going from 5 kilobytes to 1 kilobyte, and then lower transaction fees from around a half an ADA to around 0.25 ADA now for transactions over there. I don't think it's in for all transactions on the marketplace yet, but this is in for some of the ones using the V2 contracts now as well. So again, this will be not having to include the script within the transaction. So great to see things like this improving. So I talked about capacity as well. So if we look over here on C Explorer, you can see on the top here, this is the capacity of the Cardano network right now. And the green then is the actual usage of the network. So right now we're well below what the network can take. So we don't have to worry about trying to rush out new improvements. And with dApps upgrading to V2 contracts, even the usage, users that interact with them contracts, that will bring down the usage here a small bit, because the size of the transactions they're using will get smaller, which leaves more room for other transactions within them blocks as well. So something else to check out then is a video by Charles last night. It is just over a half an hour long, and it talks all about where Cardano is going, where we are now, and where we are going. Talking a lot about Voltaire and Basho, definitely one to check out. He goes into some technical, but not too deep on the technical in this one, so definitely one to check out. If you're not familiar with Basho and Voltaire, what that video is all about, Basho is all about scaling, so making Cardano better, allowing it to work more optimally, work faster, allow more users on the network as well. That's what Basho and scaling is all about. So there's two different teams working on this. It's not Basho finishes and then Voltaire starts. Both are being worked on right now. Voltaire is all about governance, so giving control of Cardano to the community. So the community will decide on what improvements are made to Cardano. So I talked about increasing the block size, things like that in the future would be decided and voted on by the community, whether the size should be increased or what happens going forward as well. So when you go through this video here, we'll make it slightly bigger, but again, I'm only going to touch on the high level stuff here. So it talks all about Voltaire here. Starts off writing in this corner, but as if you've seen Charles's whiteboard or blackboard videos before, then you'll see they generally end up with something like this. So this is the zoomed out version here. So talking about Basho, talked about pipelining improvements with Plutus, also talked about Mithril in there as well. Like I said, it was in Cardano 360, but you get it touches on it here and what that can bring. He talks about Hydra as well, and how Hydra, the perception lots of people have of Hydra mightn't be the correct perception, and it's more on the individual dApp level rather than being on a Lightning Network type thing that we see with Bitcoin. So again, you can check out that one there. Talks then about input endorsers, which is something I think will be massive for Cardano. Now, what he was talking about was this up here would allow us to compete with any of the top blockchains right now. And this one here is what just sees us out into 5-10 years and beyond in terms of scalability and improvements. So he says about input endorsers that he doesn't think we need it in 2023, that even beyond that, that what we have now with the improvements from Plutus and the improvements to come will be more than enough before we even get to input endorsers. On a high level, input endorsers, basically it means that we will have more blocks, more frequent blocks on Cardano, but not every block will be a consensus block. So right now we have one block every 20 seconds. So everything goes into that, and that is the block that determines what is actually goes onto the chain. They're looking at having more frequent blocks. So you can kind of see it here. I'm not sure if I'll be able to zoom in and editing, but this here you would have more frequent blocks happening here, and then every 20 seconds, I don't think it's fully defined yet, then you would have your consensus block, which finalizes everything that happened in between. It means that you can have a huge improvement in throughput on the network. But when we hear more on that, I'll talk about it. He says the SIPs have already been put together. We're going to hear about them in the Cardano Summit. So he's going to do a talk on that, talking all about the SIPs that are there and what the process will be going forward, because he said it's not just a simple, straightforward change that could happen to the network here. So the community Voltaire needs to be in place to decide what happens here, because it's going to change a lot of the structure. So he talks about sidechains as well and the role that they're going to play in Cardano. So I don't want to start getting into individual areas, but this one is definitely worth checking out for where Cardano could actually go. I can see Babel. He talks about the Babel fees that could be there as well, and how staking on Cardano could change going forward as well. So we'll learn more at the Cardano Summit in terms of the SIPs and what they could potentially bring, and that will open it up for people to come in and start looking at these and deciding what route we should go and what we shouldn't. Potentially in the future, when you're staking, if the SPO you're staking with is helping to run sidechains as well, you could be earning tokens from the sidechain as well as earning ADA for your staking, because you're helping secure not only Cardano but helping to secure the sidechain as well. So something else to consider as well is a lot of people talk about TPS and transactions per second when they're measuring how fast the blockchain is. With Cardano and with chains that use the eutxo model, or Cardano with its eutxo model, it's a bit harder to paint that with just TPS as the only measure, because Cardano might have one transaction per second at one stage, but within that one transaction that happens, potentially you could have up to 100 or more actual assets being moved within that transaction. We've seen different things going around, examples of sending 100 native assets to 100 different accounts all within the one transaction. One place to really take a look at that is Peter's version here, eutxo.org, and he has done a really great job on this. Version 1 is live at the minute, and this is version 2, what he's working at here. You can see what it does is it shows you in real time what's actually contained within a Cardano transaction. So if I pause on this, or actually we'll go to, this is V1 here. So what you can see is V2 isn't live just yet, but this is real time, the blocks being created on the Cardano Cardano blockchain. So what you can see is this here, this one transaction has a massive amount of native tokens in this one. Then you see different transactions with just ADA, one with MinSwap, NFTs. This transaction here has Pavia, Hosky, MinSwap. So it's not as simple as one transaction equals one output. You can have hundreds of outputs from one transaction. But again, we'll look at that in a future video. Looking forward to seeing version 2 going live. Peter really has done a phenomenal job on this and developed it himself as well. So keep an eye on that if you're interested in checking out what's actually happening real time. Moving on then, we look at Axo. You might have previously known of this as Maladex. I've talked about them on the channel here before because they're looking to do things a bit different in the DEX space. Talked a lot about their white paper because they went into a lot of in-depth detail. One of the better white papers I've seen in a long time from a dApp building as well. So they're now known as Axo, and I'm hoping to bring on Yarik onto the channel in the next week or so to talk all about it and get some of the questions answered that I have as well. If you have any, do leave them down below as well, and I'll try and put them to him whenever I can nail down an interview there as well. If we look at the website here, you can see how it actually works. So traditionally with an AMM DEX, you have your contract and acts for your liquidity pools. All of the funds are sent into this, and you mainly have one, there might be two contracts depending on the interactions that are happening there. But what they are doing here, and this is what I want to dive a bit deeper into how this all works, is they're going to have auto-generating smart contracts. So a unique programmable swap is created for every order and trading strategy that a user deploys. So they're not just going to be straight market orders and limit orders as well. Do I have them here? So they talk all about here, look at it here, what the auto-generating contracts are. So common smart contracts require users to loosen custody over their digital assets. Programmable swaps do not. Funds remain under your control until the trade execution or cancellation. So if we come down here, where is it? So they do a comparison here, but I'll get into this again. Talking about decentralization, non-custodial, formally verified. This here is one that could be big as well. So you can share your trade strategies. So you can actually create different trading strategies within the platform, and if they're successful, you can actually share them out and let others use them as well. There's for and against for sharing your strategies. If you have a strategy that works very well, if you let too many people in, then it could influence how the actual assets work, if they're low liquidity assets. But that's definitely, you can expect a lot of videos in around this type of stuff in time as well, once they do launch, like custom strategy creation, the financial instruments that they're going to have as well, and the unlimited order types. Where is that one? So order types. So this is what we're used to. On a DEX, you would have a market order, which is the order goes through straight away and buys at whatever the best market price it can get. A limit order then is where you set the price that you want to buy or sell at, and it gets triggered when the actual market moves there. But if you start to look down here, if you've used centralized exchanges, you might be familiar with stop loss or stop market, even these ones here, take profit and stop limit. But when you start to look down here, they're going to offer a lot of different types of orders as well. Dollar cost average is one that I think could be really big as well for people who just want to DCA into the market every, as you can see here on the t-shirt, DCA is something I talk about a lot. Dollar cost average, don't ever just go all in at a set price. You go in at different price levels, or some people do it on the first of every month. They will buy a set amount of a crypto or whatever they're going into and just set the time period. So these types of things here, if they can automate that type of stuff, will be massive as well. So look, I'll get into all of that when I get your eco onto the channel. And if you have specific questions, do leave them down below and I'll try and get into them as well. This video got on a bit longer than planned. Hopefully you got some value. Do share it out if you did. Leave questions, comments, anything like that below. I do appreciate you watching. Thanks. I'll talk to you soon.